One of the most important questions someone answers in life is, what is my vocation? But that question's not easy to answer. It requires discernment, prayer, and spiritual direction. Hi, I'm Billy Atwell, Director of Communications for the Diocese of Raleigh. On May 11th, the Holy Father has called the Catholic Church to a World Day of Prayer for Vocations. Bishop Michael Burbidge joins me to discuss this day of prayer and the call each person has to serve God through the vocation he's called them to. Bishop Burbidge, thank you very much for joining me.
Thank you, Billy.
So tell us a little bit about what the World Day of Prayer for Vocations is and how it got its start.
Yes, I think it's 51 years old. And so it's exactly the title. It's one of those titles that actually explains what it is, a World Day of Prayer for Vocations. Because as you said, that's the mandate from the Lord himself. Pray that laborers will be sent into the harvest. So this is a day, this is something we should do every day. But in the life, in our busy lives and lives of the church, we need reminders. So a day focused on this, specifically this gospel mandate to pray for vocations is the purpose of celebrating it.
Now, the Pope has chosen for the theme this year, Vocations, Witness to Truth. Tell us a little bit about what does that mean to be a witness to truth, especially in the context of vocations?
Yes, and certainly in this Easter season, we're seeing the apostles being sent forth. And the Lord says, go forth, you're consecrated in truth to be my witnesses. So a vocation is witnessing to the one who has chosen us, to the one who is calling us, the truth who is Jesus Christ.
And we recently had two ordinations to the transitional diaconate, our seminarians, God willing, who will become priests. What was some of your message to them about the vocation that they're stepping into?
Oh, what a wonderful day, and everyone's still talking about the joy on the faces of Rob and Ian, our two young men who were ordained, which is what their vocation should be about. As our Holy Father reminds us, it's about joy, the joy of the gospel. And my message to them was the fact to remember that it was the Lord who chose them. And the Lord who chose them asks a lot of them. A lot is entrusted to preach the truth of the gospel in love and to serve humbly in imitation of Christ who washed the feet of his disciples. But they do so always with the strength that comes from God. So go forth with zeal and enthusiasm and joy.
Now, for Pope Francis's message in this 51st World Day of Prayer for Vocations, he begins by referencing scripture where Jesus said that the people were like sheep without a shepherd. You know, we've heard that a lot, but what is a priest's role in being a shepherd to the people? What does that mean? What does that look like?
A shepherd's a beautiful image, that of a one who gathers, the one who leads, one who seeks those who may be lost. And I think that image is at the heart of the vocation of the priest. And especially with our Holy Father, Pope Francis, emphasizing with special attention to those who feel abandoned, to those who may have lost hope, to those who are disillusioned, good people, beautiful hearts, but may have lost the way. So gently, kindly, lovingly inviting them back and assuring them that here in the church, the heart of the church, they will find a home.
That encouragement is instrumental. Not only in the life of anyone's walk with God, but within vocation, you know, there's a lot of crosses to bear, whether it's married life, whether it's the priesthood or religious life. What encouragement do you offer when you're working with seminarians? You have a history with working with seminarians and seminaries. What encouragement do you offer them when they're having a rough day and it seems too much?
Yeah, well, I say always tell them that, and as you said, this is part of all of our vocations, all of us baptized in Christ. But I would always remind them that if in living out their vocation and in the course of their daily lives they are experiencing that cross or that struggle, it's a call to holiness. At that very moment where the cross is heavy or the suffering that they may be enduring, that's an invitation to holiness. Because when that suffering or that hardship or that difficult moment or that period of doubt or even when the faith is not as strong as one might want it to be, if it's united to Christ, that's the heart of holiness. And so not in the midst of you know, feeling a burden or a day or a certain period of time not being as great as it always has been, not to despair or be distressed at that moment, but saying, how is God using this moment to reawaken in me my utter dependence on God. And that, of course, leads to saintly holiness.
Now, Pope Francis has also said that a vocation only comes out of good soil. How, in parish life, how can the average parishioner, member of the faithful, be good soil for seminarians and for current priests?
So the first, of course, is what we're talking about, prayer. What the Lord, what do you want me to do for you? Lord, I always say to our people, the Lord asks the question, what do you want me to do for you? That's what he asked the disciples, he asks us, right? So what do you want me to do for you? Lord, grant this local church, this diocese of Raleigh, more priests, because we need them. We have parishes that are without the great gift of daily mass, because we don't have enough priests. We have priests living alone who are doing the work of three or four. Give this church, Lord, more priests, more consecrated religious, more people dedicating their entire lives to service of the church. And also say, be the encourager, be the inviter. If you see someone, a young adult or young person in your church or anyone discerning, and you recognize that that person may truly have a vocation. Maybe God's using you as the instrument to open that person's heart and say, hey, have you ever thought about that? Because I think you'd be a great priest. You can't imagine the words. Every priest will tell you who said that to him first, whether it be a teacher or a family member or a friend. But maybe the Lord's asking us to be that. So plant that's a seed of invitation.
When you were discerning the priesthood, who was that encourager for you? Who was that person that really, encouraged you to really think about this and pray about it?
Yeah, there were two, actually. One was a high school teacher, a priest. We had priests teaching us high school who I did not think he knew my name. And he called me over one day and just said, have you ever thought about being a priest? And I kind of was thinking about it, but I wasn't going to acknowledge at that point. And I said, no. I said, well, I wish you would, because I think you'd be a great priest. And from that moment on, it changed. And he was here when I was installed as Bishop of Raleigh.
Oh, that must have been a special moment.
Yes. And then the other one was a newly ordained priest. I was a high school student, and a man right out of the seminary, freshly ordained. I, for some reason, was just in awe of him. I was starstruck almost. He was the one of the finest, holiest, joyful priests, a friend of mine now. And he also asked me that question. And again, he was here when I was installed as the Bishop of Raleigh too, so I was very blessed to have both of them on that special day.
How does a priestly ministry change when you're ordained a bishop? So you have an Episcopal ministry, which is unique, but you're still a priest, and you refer to your priests as brother priests.
Right.
So you share in that. How does your ministry change when you're ordained a bishop?
Well, in two ways, because you are a brother priest, but when you are the bishop or the ordinary of a diocese, you're also the spiritual father. And so, your brother priests are also your spiritual sons. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a unique relationship. And ministry changes most significantly in that you do not have that one community to call your own, where you're spending time with day in and day out, getting to know all the families, being with the ministers. As a bishop, as an apostle, right, a successor of the apostles, you have to go out to the whole diocese. And so as a bishop, I'm not in any one place for a significant period of time. I'm all over the diocese, entrusted with all the parishes. And that's a great blessing, because I get to see the whole diocese in its beauty and its diversity and its uniqueness. That's a great, great blessing. But the difficult part at first is that, you don't stay. You have a wonderful day, but then you leave. And that's what the apostles did. And that's the ministry of a bishop.
What are we doing here in the Diocese of Raleigh to foster vocations? What initiatives do you have in place to encourage
them? Yeah, and thank you for asking that, because I owe a big thanks to the faithful of this diocese who are doing a great deal to foster vocations, to encourage our seminarians, our students in the grade schools, and our faith formation programs. I owe a big thanks. This diocese has created a wonderful culture of vocations. So, for example, we pray a prayer for vocations. Holy cards are all over our parishes and in our homes. We pray by name for our seminarians. And so I can go into a grade school and I'll point to the card and they'll know who that seminarian is. The encouragement they give to our seminarians, notes and letters. And also, I think the constant encouragement of support that is sent in so many various ways.
Now, you also have an important role with the USCCB with regard to vocations.
The United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, there's various committees that, you know, represent the great work of the conference, which includes so many ministries. And I just began a 10-year term as the chairman of the Committee on Clergy, Consecrated Life, and Vocation. So
that's pretty broad.
That's pretty broad. That includes a lot. But it's a great honor. And so I work closely with other bishops and a wonderful staff at the Conference of Bishops. And we try to assist dioceses in all those areas and the associations and organizations that are represented with priests and deacons and religious and seminaries. So it's a great work. I really do love this work.
Very good. Well, I appreciate you taking some time to
talk
with us about vocations. As a reminder, World Day of Prayer for Vocations is May 11th. Please keep our seminarians in your prayers, and please say a special prayer for a young person who has a vocation but might not know it yet. Pray that they would see God's will in their life. If you would like to learn more about vocations to the priesthood, go to RaleighVocations.org and follow us on Twitter at RaleighVocare. You can follow Bishop Burbidge on Twitter for commentary and spiritual reflections at Bishop Burbidge. For more videos from the diocese, go to youtube.com/Diocese of Raleigh. To listen to our podcast, search for the Diocese of Raleigh on iTunes or go to dioceseofraleigh.org. Thank you for watching, and God bless.